All right, let's come back now and look at the book of Revelation and take a few moments to step back. And as we begin the book, this is a different kind of book. It's not an epistle. It's a prophetic piece of literature. And as such, it's not really an irreducible minimum type of literature. It's done differently. Rather, when we take a look at it, what we'll find is that chapter one lays out a vision that goes on for the 22 chapters of the book. The chapters actually are laid out and divided by the end of chapter one. So let's start off by saying what the book is and what it's not. This is the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his bondservants the things which must soon take place. And he sent and communicated it by his angel to his bondservant John. Stop right there. This isn't just a revelation of the end times. It is a revelation of Jesus Christ and things that come. So it's a revelation of Jesus and things to come, not things to come and Jesus. Does that make sense? In other words, when I get through the picture of this, I should walk away with a greater picture of who Jesus is. So in order to see God as he is, we should look closely at the portrait of his son, the Savior, as John reveals him in the book of Revelation. It's about painting a picture. That's really what it's about. It's the art and beauty of who Jesus is, because you get an incomplete picture of Jesus when you dismiss prophecy. Jesus, the Hallmark card Jesus that is out there on the web right now, of Jesus who just loves everybody, is never the Jesus of Revelation. He's always the Jesus of the manger. And when you're going to get a full picture of Jesus, you need to see him not only as the sacrificial lamb, but the lion of the tribe of Judah. He's both. He's not one or the other, he's both. And so there's some necessary background information that you probably want to put on the front page just for Revelation, okay? First, the time was the waning years of the first century, somewhere between 81 and 96. That's the time of Emperor Domitian. And John was exiled to a penal colony on the island of Patmos. Patmos is a little tiny island, a little horseshoe-shaped island in the middle of the Aegean Sea, that's east of Greece. And it has no water of its own. It's a rock where they bring in all the water. So it was a penal colony in which they didn't have to have a lot of guards because there was really no way to get off the island. You couldn't possibly swim far enough to get away. And so you would drown if you tried. There wasn't a lot of trees. There weren't a lot of trees on the island. There are now today by those who bring in water to water the trees. But as a result, really rocks don't, you can't make a boat out of rocks. And so there wasn't really a way for you to like create a raft and get over, you know, get off and escape. And if you did, you had to understand pirates were a huge problem in the time. So the chances are you're going to be picked up in a raft at sea and turned into a slave. So it really wasn't going to be a good ending for you no matter what. The author of the book of the Revelation of Jesus Christ is John the Apostle. He is one of the 12 original disciples of Jesus. He is the son of Zebedee, the fisherman of Bethsaida on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee. And his mama's name was Salome, and his brother's name was James. And so we know a good bit about him. John had an extraordinary career as a disciple. He was part of the inner circle of Jesus with Peter, James, and John. And he was selected to witness several things that the other disciples didn't see. For instance, he was there in Mark 5 for the raising of Jairus' daughter. He was there for the transfiguration in Matthew 17. He was there for the preparation by Peter and John of the Last Supper. He was there for the witness of the agony in the Garden of Gethsemane in John 18 when Jesus went to pray. He's in the inner circle. John has a nickname. He's one of the sons of what? Thunder. That meant he had trouble keeping his mouth shut. So you got to have a little bit of sympathy for him. He's also one of the ones in Luke chapter 9 that called Jesus to call down fire from heaven and turn all the Samaritans into toast. So he was rather biased and he had some prejudices and he had a big mouth. But God used him. He was also called the disciple that Jesus loved. He's probably the youngest of the disciples and he's the last one living. I think it's important for you to make some mental note, if not physical note, that John was the last of the disciples still standing. He had watched all of his friends killed, mostly for the gospel of Christ. So as an apostle, he was the author of the Gospel of John, And he wrote the three epistles of John, and he wrote the book of Revelation. So that accounts for five pieces of writing, okay? Some believe his gospel account may have been written in part to deal with a heresy called the Ebionite heresy, where Christ did not exist before Mary, but she gave birth to him in the flesh and he became the Son of God. That might be the reason he wrote that one. But this one was written very specifically as a complete testimony of Jesus and who he was. As an elder in the Asian church, John discipled the early church's father, who was called Polycarp, who later became the bishop of Smyrna. And Polycarp, in turn, discipled Irenaeus, who passed on stories about John. So the stories we have about John are two generations of disciples after him by the guy who was discipled by the guy who was discipled by John, okay? And so all of our stories come from him. But one of my favorites was at the Roman bath in Ephesus, where John was having a dispute with a man by the name of Corinthus, who walked into the bath, and out of the bathhouse, John ran screaming with a towel around him, saying, "Let us fly, lest even the bathhouse fall down, because Corinthus, the enemy of the truth, has walked within." Apparently, his tempter and his tongue were never completely subdued in his life. And so John survived all of his contemporary apostles. And we have a record from about the year 200 by Tertullian in something called the Prescription of Heretics that says that he was plunged into boiling oil in Rome, but suffered nothing from it. So some people believe that John, they attempted to boil John in oil before he was ordered to go to Patmos. We just don't know. Jerome, a few hundred years after John, told of the tradition of that, but we just don't know if it's true. Let's talk a little bit about the letter, if we can. Revelation is a letter. The letter's written to seven churches in Asia Minor. That's Western Turkey today. And the letter has seven "blessed are the" statements. Seven times you see "blessed are" in the letter. The letter's organized into seven blocks of information about earth, heaven, earth, heaven, earth, heaven. You'll get seven of each. And what's interesting is that there are seven identifications of people inside the throne room of God. He picks out seven people and tells you who they are. He has three sets of judgments, but each of them are in sevens. So John is trying to press seven, 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 which is a number of what? Completion. He's trying to end the story. And each judgment set has seven, but also Revelation 14 has seven angels that aid the believer during the tribulation period. Over and over and over and over, he presses out the imagery of seven. So you're going to see a lot of sevens in the book. Now, you saw that before, by the way. You saw that in the Gospel of John, where there are seven I ams and seven I do's. So this is John's trademark writing. Now, quick look at Revelation 1. Look at verses 1 through 3, and this is the cause of the work. What's the cause? The book was written to do what? The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him, to show his bondservants the things which must soon take place. The book was written to show Jesus, to explain the end, but something else. Look at verse 3. What's the other thing it does? It shows Jesus, it tells you of the end, and what does it do? It blesses the student who reads it. This is the only book of the 66 that promises a blessing to the person who reads it. This book says, you will be blessed if you read this book. Now, does that mean you'll be happy if you read this book? No, it means that the book itself contains a blessing because it's an image or picture of Jesus Christ. So the cause of the work is in 1 through 3. The collaboration involved in the work is verses 4 through 8. Who are the collaborators that wrote the book? Well, in verse 4, who's the first one? Circle John, because you don't have a book without a writer, right? Okay, it's true that Jesus is there, but there's one before him. It is the one who sits on the throne. Who's that? Who's the one who was, is, and is to come? If you take the Hebrew for was, is, and is to come, you get Yahweh or Jehovah. So Jehovah, or God, the Father. Also the seven spirits who are before the throne. So you have the Spirit of God. Also Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. So what you have is John, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. And those four are your collaborators to write the book. Now, what are the circumstances of the book in verses 9 and 10? I, John, your brother and fellow partaker in the tribulation and kingdom and perseverance which are in Jesus, was on the island called Patmos because of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus. In other words, I was in exile on Patmos, but what was I doing in verse 10? Okay, so he's worshiping, okay? He is in a place of worship, at a time of worship, on a place of exile. So I'm at Patmos in worship. And then verses 11 through 18, here's the commissioning of the book. The book is commissioned when the Lord says to him, write in a book what you see. Send it to the seven churches, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. I turned to see the voice that was speaking with me. And having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. The very first thing he saw was seven lamps. Okay? And he says, he heard a voice, write down what you see. And he turned, and he looks, and what are there? Seven lampstands. And it says, and in the middle of the lampstands I saw one like the Son of Man, a person walking like the Son of Man, clothed in a robe, reaching to his feet, girded about with his chest with a golden sash. That's the priestly garment, right? Golden sash. And his head and his hair were like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze when it had been made to glow in a furnace. And his voice was like the sound of many waters. Where have you seen this kind of description before? Daniel 7, you've seen this description before. And we jumped over to this when we were in Daniel 7:9, and look in the description there and you'll see something like this. Interestingly enough, it goes on and it says, in his right hand he held seven stars, and out of his mouth a sharp two-edged sword, and his face was like the sun shining in its strength. Now here's the thing. A two-edged sword was the kind of sword they had in Thrace, a Thracian sword, and it cuts both ways. I know that sounds funny, but many swords were actually one-sided swords, like a knife is often one-sided, is a blunt side and then a sharp side. Most swords in the Bible were actually forward-thrusting swords. Thracian swords had two sharp edges, so it worked in both directions, okay? Why is it important to say out of his mouth came a sword that cut in both directions? Why would that matter? When we say the phrase it cuts both ways, what do we mean? Yeah, that what works for us also works against us. Another phrase, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. In other words, it cuts both ways. His words are both just in both directions and holy and righteous in both directions. Now, stop and see this. You're looking at this incredible commissioning that goes on. John's being commissioned to record a message from Jesus to the seven churches. First, he sees the seven lamps, and those will represent your seven churches. Later on, you'll see that. And the Son of Man walking in them, in other words, Jesus in the middle of his seven churches. Each church is seen as a lamp on a certain place to a certain, the lighthouse to a certain area, let's say it that way. And Jesus is walking among them. And when he sees this priestly Jesus coming toward him, he says, when I saw him, I fell at his feet as like a dead man. We saw that in Daniel 8, didn't we? When I saw this one, I fell and I had no strength. He placed his right hand on me, said, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of the grave of Hades. Therefore, and let's stop right there. Jesus touches him, raises him, and says, listen, I was dead, I'm alive again. Clearly, that's who this is. There's no question this is Jesus after the resurrection. So he sees the vision of the resurrected Christ, and what is he dressed as? He's dressed as a priest because that's Jesus' job right now. He's an intercessory priest. That's part of what Hebrews argued. He's an intercessory priest. And so I saw him in his priestly regalia. I saw him raised from the dead, and he gave me an instruction. You should have a box around verse 19 if you don't already, and that box should remind you of the outline of the book. The outline or the contents of the book are, write the following three boxes. Doesn't say it really that way, but that's how it would say it if it was a GCBI class, okay? Write this in three boxes. First, write the things which you have seen. So the very first box is what came before verse 19. Well, now, class, you don't have to be deep into the biblical world to know what came before verse 1, chapter 1, verse 19. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 18. Good. So our first box is going to be 1 through 18. Stuff you've seen. And what was the content of what he's seen? The vision of risen Christ. So 119 is going to give me this. The second box then is write the things which are, and that will be following chapter 1 and verse 20. He goes into chapters 2 and 3, and this will be letters to seven churches. Those are seven churches that existed at the time in which John was writing. They may be representative of churches throughout the ages, but they don't have to be. This is the things which exist during the church age. And then the third thing you should write is the biggest box of the book that begins in chapter 4 and goes all the way to chapter 22. And this is, write the things which shall be metatauta, after the things which are. And when you go to chapter 4, verse 1, if you look at chapter 4, verse 1, it begins with the words metatauta. Tauta, after the things which are. So this will be chapter 4 and goes all the way to chapter 22 at the end of the book. 119 therefore divides the book into three sections and says, write the things which you have seen, the things which are, and the things which shall be after the things which are. What I'd like to do is get through this very quickly and just sort of outline what it is he saw that existed at the time in which he wrote. But before we go on, look at verse 20, because there's 20 verses in chapter 1, not 19. And the 20th verse gives what I call the curiosity of the book. Written into the book are signs. So verse 20 says, as for the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand, the seven and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. How did I know back earlier when I said there were seven lamps that those were seven churches? I read the end of the verses. So here's what I know. The curiosity of the book is weird stuff will be seen, but very often if you keep reading, the weird stuff will be explained. So the curiosity of the book is you can't just fixate on reading. Don't just read like a chapter a day of Revelation and think you're going to get it. Because sometimes three chapters later, he's explaining what you saw three chapters ago. So if you read it and you left, you didn't understand it. All you saw were stars and lamps, and you don't know what they are. You got to keep reading to get to what the point of the curiosity is. It's interesting that in the text, it says that he literally sent this letter, but he did something else. In verse 1, it says, he sent and communicated it by his angel. I like the word in King James, it says, he sent and signified it by his angel. He signified it. In quite a literal way, Jesus included the signs in the book. He could have made Revelation like a novel. The next thing I'm going to do is do this, and then an asteroid will crash into this, and then there will be this pestilence. He doesn't do it. He does it in pictures. Why does he do it in pictures? Why is Revelation given to John in pictures? All of us are pretty visual. If you look for the things that have impacted you the most in your life, why are movies more impacting than radio? Because you can hear it, but also see it. So, John, would you be open to the idea that much of the problem of the book of Revelation is very simple? John sees things that if Ashley saw them, she would know what they were. John doesn't know what they are. If she saw San Francisco, she would go, oh, yeah, that's San Francisco. If John sees it, he says, and I saw a great city of glass, and it had lights of every color, and into the night it lit up. And he's so amazed by things, you'd be going, yeah, it's San Francisco. They turned the lights on, okay? But he hasn't seen what you've seen. So a lot of what gets John caught up is not what would catch you up. Let me say it this way. If Revelation were seen in a vision now, it wouldn't be nearly as unusual as it was to him. Why? Because we're getting closer to it. Can you imagine, when I was a kid, the whole idea that some witnesses would die on the street in Jerusalem and all the world would see it at one time, that was before we had CNN. We didn't know that there could be instant news broadcast all over the world at the same time. When I was a kid, that didn't happen. The very first worldwide broadcast ever made was from the moon. We didn't know we could do it any other. You know why? Because they were sending out a signal that was picked up all over the earth. Then we started to go, satellites. If we float satellites around, we could do the same thing. But that was after I was born. In the last 53 years, we figured out how to do this. That meant people who were preaching Revelation 100 years ago had no concept of how this worked. I want you to understand, as you read the book now, it's not that hard to understand, but it's because you're getting closer to the time. There's still some stuff you're not going to understand, but most of it's going to be a lot easier for you. Okay? All right, let's get into then, in verse 1 of chapter 2, we should begin by circling the names of each of the seven churches. Do you have them circled in your Bible? Okay, so you should have 2:1-7 as Ephesus, 8-11 as Smyrna, 12-17 as Pergamum, and 18-29 as Thyatira. Chapter 3, verses 1-6 is Sardis. Chapter 3, verses 7-13 is Philadelphia. Chapter 3, verses 14-22 is Laodicea. And so what you have is that same phrase, and we use the phrase, everybody sing, please, that sounds pretty lovely. Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. Everybody sing, please, that sounds pretty lovely, or that sounds pretty lousy. Doesn't matter which way you remember it, but that's the way you can remember the tops of it. In each of these seven, each of them will offer you something about what's going on during the church age. Here's the thing. When you step away from it, what you should end up with is some very important things about what God is doing in the church today and what he meant specifically in the church in the first century. So, I like to refer to these as seven deadly sins. These are seven churches that each one have some issues. You remember that the term seven deadly sins actually comes from Proverbs 6, where it says, six things the Lord hates and the seventh his soul detests, namely a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plots, feet that are swift to run into mischief, a deceitful witness that utters lies, and he who sows discord among brothers. All of those are important because Proverbs 6, 16 to 19 tell you about them. But the seven deadly sins as we have them in this are like some really difficult things, sinful choices that cripple believers in different times in the church. So think about them this way. These aren't just something simple. Each one of these tells us something about that church that is powerful because it's actually hindering them, sin issues that are hindering them from becoming what God wants them to be. They're not all exactly sin issues, but they're all hindrances. All right, in verses 1 through 7, chapter 2, verses 1 through 7, do you have a specific sin for Ephesus? I would use neglected priorities. And what do I mean by that? The phrase in the scripture is left your first love. You were in love with Jesus and you fell out of love. But what do I mean by that? They left their first love. They began in love with the Savior. They began worshiping and thanking and praising and sharing because of Him. But what began as a passion ended up as a program. Guys, this is going to happen in your life. What begins as a passion can end up as a program. And the issue was not a lack of vigilance against error. Look at verse 2. He says very clearly that I know your deeds and your toil and your perseverance, that you cannot tolerate evil men. He's not saying they embraced evil. He's saying their heart for God ran out. It is possible. It is plausible. It is almost inevitable that you will find yourself lacking passion at some point in your life and you'll need to hear these words. How does that happen to a church? How does it happen to a believer? How do you get to the point where you just ran out of gas for God? How does that happen? Well, one of the things that can happen is we can forget whose pleasure our life is for. We can get so caught up thinking that we live for our own pleasure that we forget we live for the Lord's pleasure. There's another thing that happens in churches, and I call it program creep. What is program creep? All of a sudden, the program becomes so hard to run, you can barely have time to pray because you're just running after the program. You know why? Partly because churches are good at starting things and never good at stopping them. What happens is we can gauge our passion for God Himself, or we can gauge our passion for the program. And what happens is when you're chasing the program, often you're not chasing a passion for Jesus. What's interesting is, what do you think John told the church at Ephesus? Okay, the program's running you. You've lost your passion. What's the first piece of advice you would probably give to somebody who was in that? Without looking at the scripture, tell me your advice for the person who's, you've been working so hard that you've lost your passion. What's the first thing you would think of? You need a go back. And would that include not working? See, the first thing the flesh will say is, you got to stop doing what you're doing. That is not what he said. What he said in verse 5 is you have to remember, recognize what you left behind. You have to repent. That is change your mind about the way you're doing the action, and you have to return to the old works by turning back. He's not saying take a vacation. What happens today is people think that the answer to stress is a vacation. The answer to stress is repentance. You gotta listen, when you get stressed out about things, you can go on vacation and come back and they're still going to be there and you'll be stressed again. So you have to change you. You can change locations. That doesn't change the problem. But when you change your attitude about the problem, that actually changes the way you engage the problem. So he says, I don't want you to run. I don't want you to quit working. I want you to go back to the reason you're doing what you're doing in the first place and reignite the reason. Couple comes in for counseling because they got married and they loved each other and real passion for each other. Now they're five kids in. The life is so incredibly hectic they can hardly stand it. And they're finally at each other's throat because they barely have any time to get anything done. So what do I tell them? Put your babies in the closet and go away? you know, hire a babysitter and don't spend any time with it. No. I say, okay, stop. Reignite the reasons you got together to begin with. Because these five children are supposed to interact with parents who have a passionate love for one another. Why did you love each other in the beginning? Tell me what you saw in your spouse that made them the person you wanted to be your spouse. And I go back to the beginning. You know what? Invariably, in one session, people go out and they thank me for that. And here's the funny part. I didn't do anything but remind them of where they started. That's all I did. There was a reason you loved him. Why? Why did you love him? And there's a reason you loved her. Why did you love her? Okay, what he says is go back and remember why it is you're serving Jesus Christ to begin with. The prescription for losing proper priorities is remembering what the right priority is, going back and re-grabbing. All right, in verses 8 through 11, we have the second church. Do you have a sin or a hindrance for the second church? Church at Smyrna was tempted to run under fire or had fear of opposition. By the way, I think a lot of churches are here now. I think that's exactly where they are. They're afraid. They're afraid to stand up and say the truth because they're afraid they will actually lose something in popularity or lose something in the offering plate, lose something in the operations of the church, and so they're afraid. It's very clear to me that they pulled back their witness because of the fear that reactions will be painful. This is 40 miles north of Ephesus, and in 8 through 11, John recorded Jesus' words. Look at verse 8. It says, to the angel of the church of Smyrna, write, drop down to verse 10, do not fear what you are about to suffer. Do you see it? Underline, do not fear what you are about to suffer in verse 10, and that's the heart of what he has to say. The church of Smyrna was gripped with fear. Jesus knew their physical troubles. He knew their material needs. Verse 9 says, I know what you need. I know your troubles. But the problem was, instead of promising the church a free ride in the coming days, he promised them more persecution. Look at verse 9. He says, I know your tribulation. I know your poverty and the blasphemy by those who say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Stop right there. Do not fear what you're about to suffer. Is this good news? No. He doesn't say, hey, I'm about to take the pressure off. He says, do not fear, it's about to get worse. Behold, the devil is about to cast some of you into prison so that you will be tested, so that you will have tribulation for 10 days. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. This is not a letter I want to receive from God. This is not a letter I want to receive. He says, new imprisonments are going to be ordered. New troubles are going to be ordained to arrive. New word of martyrdom. How do believers face the rising Antichrist sentiment that are waves out there? Mostly with fear. Much of what you're reading on the web right now is older believers looking in fear at where we're going. What they're worried about is that the changes that are happening governmentally will come about to be the persecution of the church. That's what they're worried about. So remember that complaining was not the church's watermark. And we got to check our whining, right? Second, we need to remember that it's not our permanent home here on earth. Believers have to constantly reinforce that heaven is our home. Spiritual warfare is our constant companion. Here's what I want you to know. If you're involved in a church that says nothing about spiritual warfare and very little about heaven, find another church. Because what you're involved in is a church that is imbalanced to the point that they are not seeing what is necessary. There's coming a time when the church will have to focus on exactly where we're going. A church that is focused on creating the kingdom on earth is going to be tempted to lose its edge when it sees the temporary situation that's coming. So I would just tell you that's happening. I see it all over the place. I see a rising tide of churches that are all about making us popular, but not about making us true. Go to the third one, 12 through 17. Unless there's a question, I'm going to keep right on going. 12 through 17. Third church is Pergamum. And this is an hour and a half drive north of the city of Smyrna. and it's a beautiful coastline that you drive up, and it's really nice. And when you get up there, you get to Pergamum, and I would say, do you have a title for this one? By the way, Pergamum is spelled several different ways. Pergamum, Pergamon, same place. What's the hindrance involved in it? What was the teaching of Balaam? What is the reference to the teaching of Balaam? So it was temptation to compromise. And this was compromise of principles. The temptation to compromise their principles. They're being tempted by people who are speaking to them falsehoods that have been paid to speak falsehoods to tempt them to do wrong. Seductive teachings that drew them away into forbidden food and immoral practices. In other words, I'm going to tell you that I believe what he's saying is people taking liberty with Christian liberties that are not Christian. People trying to introduce liberties that aren't real. And so what he says is they're introducing, listen, be careful. Guys, be careful how much you focus on Christian liberties. Focus more on Christian responsibilities than Christian liberties. When you spend a lot of time focusing on Christian liberties, everybody wants to talk about what they have the right to do. Spend a lot of time on what you have the responsibility to do, because that's going to make you a healthy, viable Christian, okay? The other thing I'll tell you is that some of them were involved in the mysticism of the Nicolaitans. By the way, the Nicolaitans believed that intimate revelations that were given privately caused some people to be the people you had to go to find the truth of the word. These were people who believed they had a special vision from God. And as a result, they lacked objective accountability. Let me say it this way. The Nicolaitans were people who believed that the God told me. They're the God told me people. Well, the problem is, if you had a dream and God told you, how can anybody hold you accountable? Because who's going to tell you that you're wrong if God told you? And that was the problem. The problem was the Nicolaitans walked around with this beyond accountability, God told me mysticism. Do you know any believers like that today? Do you ever hear people like God told me to do this? See, there's a lot of them out there. And what I need you to see is that the God told me people were in existence in the first century. Believers that want to do things hanging over the edge into the world without accountability are abundant today. But every growing believer needs to be aware of people who are going to say, well, God told me I could do this, or God told me I should do that. The thing is, God is speaking, but he's always speaking in harmony with his word, never against it. So if you try to say, well, God told me to do this, but what you're saying is not in harmony with the word of God, you are causing God to either step on his own word or you heard something else. Okay, how about this one? Go to the fourth one. This is in verses 18 through 29, yeah? Is it through 29? Is that what it is? 18 through 20, is it 18 through 29? This is Thyatira. And in Thyatira, what were they doing wrong? Tolerating immorality. It wasn't just that she called herself a prophetess. What was she telling them to do? Look at the descriptive phrases. Because there's some good things about this church. Verse 19, I know your deeds. See, this was a church that was working. I know your love. It was a church with a heart. I know your faith. It was a biblically focused church. I know your service. It was a need-focused church. I know your perseverance. It was a steady and enduring church. And I know that your deeds of late are greater than those at first, that it was a growing church. But sadly, it was a church about to get crushed under the weight of its own sin. And the weight of its own sin is seen in verse 18. It says to the church of Thyatira, verse 20, I have this against you, that you tolerate the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, and she teaches and leads my bondservants astray so that they commit acts of immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. I want you to see it. The deadly sin mentioned here is toleration. That's the deadly sin. It wasn't the instigation of the moral teaching. It was the toleration of it. They didn't instigate it. Someone else did. This woman came in with this idea. It's they tolerated it. The toleration itself. So what's interesting is they didn't cut off the cancer. Can anybody see a way in which the church today could be susceptible to this same thing? The inability to say, you need to go because that's not God's word. That kind of strength seems awfully judgy, doesn't it? Do you think it's going to seem more or less like that in the next 10 years? Do you think it's going to seem more or less? What do you think? You think that as time goes on, you think the church is going to be seen as more tolerant or less tolerant? You think they're going to be more tolerant? Do you think that the church that's trying to walk with God will be seen as more tolerant or less tolerant? I think the danger's there. And I think that we've talked about that danger a lot, so we don't need to spend a lot of time on it. But just to say this, many people would rather experience God than study His Word. They want an experience with Him. They don't want to do the hard work you're doing. Come on, can we all agree this is hard? Can we not all agree that this has been an awful lot of hours of your life spent on basically, you know, one bound leather book? And there's an awful lot of people who just want to get to the end. Let me have a biblical worldview in a weekend. Just let me go to a seminar. Give me the bullet points. The problem is you don't really get an understanding in the bullet points. You have to wallow in the middle of Ecclesiastes and try to go, what in the world? When the tree falls in the forest, whether it falls to the north or to the south, there it is. Hello? What does that mean? When believers tolerate immoral actions, allowing them to continue unchecked because they don't want to cause conflict, here's what they do. They rob hope and kill truth. When you tolerate immoral actions within the church because you don't want a conflict, you let the immoral action win over the truth. And the fact of the matter is, you know, it's that nude beach controversy. When you tolerate it, it means you have it. All binary arguments come down to either somebody gets it or they don't. Okay? If you tolerate them doing the wrong thing, you have now licensed the wrong thing. That's the problem. So that's pretty much what he says about this particular church. Let's go on to chapter 3. And when you go to chapter 3, beginning in verse 1 all the way to verse 6, you have another church. This is the church of Sardis. Sardis. And the church itself is about spiritual apathy. What is apathy? I don't care. That's apathy. Apathy is when you don't care, okay? And they're saying spiritually they've lost the ability to care. Have you ever become apathetic about something you used to care about? How many of you took a musical instrument and became apathetic? You started off going, I really want to know this. Until one day you looked at it and said, I don't want to know it that badly. And you just walked away. Apathy is when you've lost, not pathos, passionate, not passionate. You've lost your passion. Spiritual apathy, when we allow the weakness to spread unchecked by vigilance and defense of the truth. Without defending the truth, you open the door to apathy. That's why you defend the truth. Chapter 3 opens with a letter that went to the city of Sardis, 2 hours from the modern day travels of the church before it at Thyatira. And here it says, to the church at Sardis, write this. He who has the 7 spirits of God, 7 stars, says this. I know your deeds, that you have a name that are alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Now, I think it's interesting. Sardis is one of the great cities of the ancient world. The capital city of a great empire. The Greeks used to refer to this as the greatest of all cities. Sardis was a thing. In fact, the thing I remember most about Sardis is whenever I go there, there is a column base for the old temple at Sardis that is so big that I can lie down in the base of the column and it's bigger than me. The diameter of the huge columns were bigger than 6 feet wide. I mean, imagine 6 feet wide diameters of huge columns that went up. This was one of the biggest, most incredible cities in the world, but it died. It's a city that fell. They remembered their past, but they became complacent about their present. And they kept presuming about their future. Believers often have the same kind of temptation here. Look, vigilance is the opposite of apathy, not action. Action is not the opposite of apathy. Vigilance is. In other words, you've got to be watching all the time, not just doing. And so believers face a temptation. I'm not sure how I can best illustrate this one. I know what I'll do it. There's a 4,000-mile-long Great Wall in China. 4,000 miles long. It was originally constructed by a fellow, Shi Huangdi, and the idea of this wall was to keep out those who were, it's around 200 BC. It was constructed to keep out the people who were beyond the walls, the people that were trying to get into China by the Ming Dynasty. And here's the problem. That lasted from 200 BC all the way up to the year 1644 AD, 1800 years. Do you know how they got in? They never climbed the wall. They bribed a gatekeeper. See, you can have the biggest wall possible, but if you can bribe the gatekeeper, that's your weakness. And the crazy thing is that we have to be absolutely vigilant, because nothing will breach us like our spiritual defenses like simply bribing the gatekeepers. I think one of the problems I think that happened to the body of Christ is we professionalized ministry. And when we professionalized it, we gave people paychecks. And when we gave people paychecks, we now own them. And it became possible to bribe the gatekeepers. And that's one of the big problems. Let me go on to the sixth one. 3:7, and to the angel of the church of Philadelphia, write this: I know your deeds. Behold, I have put before you an open door which no one can shut, because you have a little power and have kept my word and not denied my name. I would call this one, the one at Philadelphia, dwindling stability. The incredible shrinking church. The problem with Philadelphia wasn't that they didn't have a heart or that they didn't want to serve God. The problem was they were getting smaller and smaller and smaller. That they were dwindling in stability. And as a result, many of them became sick. They became anemic Christians. And I think what you see, I did a little thing a couple of years ago on different kinds of Christian illnesses. So I'll give you my little essay on Christian illnesses, all right? There's Alzheimer's Christians. They're the people who remember only selectively what God has done before, but fail to be able to connect what may be happening in the kingdom around them today. There's also the autistic Christian. He's stuck on a phrase and often inappropriate in responses. He's unable to connect to anyone that has no special training to understand them. There's the epileptic Christian. That's the one that's not in control of all their energies that are expended. They seem passionate but strangely disconnected from the body, randomly expending great energy not directed by any leadership or head. There's the leprous Christian. That's the one that's lost their feeling to the other parts of the body, and they're infectiously causing a spread of numbness, of insensitivity that kills good growth. Then there's the obese Christian. You may know some of these. They're ready to sit and eat a meal with no intent to get up and do anything at any time. They become expert food critics of the messages they hear. Then there's the burned Christian. And because of an experience that often has nothing to do with the current body that they're in constant need of careful handling and touchy care because they were burned in the past. Then there's the anorexic Christian. This is the one that's unable to see themselves as God says they are. They continue to have self-inspect every flaw, totally overtaken in their own faults and issues. And then there's the heart-diseased Christian. This is the one that's unable to function normally because of other contributing behaviors that have weakened their endurance. My point is that there's an awful lot of people walking into the church that never get over themselves. And because of that, we can't get a working army because they're so busy trying to stay alive. They can't quite make it for themselves. The reason we don't lead other people to Christ is we don't grow up. There's people sitting out there that have been out there for 35 years. They've heard every message, but they don't grow up. Is the problem the Bible isn't clear? I don't think so. Is the problem that the Bible isn't available to them? I don't think so. What do you think the problem really is? What's that? They don't take it seriously. There it is, right there. And until I take it seriously, you can go to the best church in the best place with the best teachers and have all these adult Bible fellowships and go off to the best seminars and still come back a baby Christian. Because you don't learn to chew meat until you're ready to chew meat. And honestly, we can pre-chew it as much as we want. You'll never grow up if you don't take it seriously. It's just the way it is. I think what happened to Philadelphia is they just continued to drift along and found themselves with dwindling stability. One of the reasons churches dwindle in stability is the ineffectiveness of making disciples that make disciples. I am facing right now churches that do not have leadership because no one trained leadership for years. I don't know why. I really don't know why. Because honestly, to me, this is the fun. This is the fun part. Training people that they'll go out and train other people is the fun part. Why would you do church if you couldn't do this? So go on to the last one, and I will end this and get us into a break. The last one is Laodicea. Now, everybody always knows about the church of Laodicea what? It's a church that is remembered for what? A lukewarm church. I believe that what their real issue was luxury distraction. I don't think that they became lukewarm because they'd rather be lukewarm than hot or cold. I think they became lukewarm because they lost their attentiveness to the real things. I think that happened for a very good reason. When we focus so much on this world's comforts, we forget this isn't the real world. So what ends up happening is that you have to go to Pamukkale someday. Pamukkale is called the Cotton Castle. It's this really cool thing. You can see the Taurus Mountains, and then there's this Cotton Castle, and it's a bunch of calcified springs that come down the side of a hillside, and they're all white. They look like white cotton candy or something. And what it is, and usually there's a lot of naked German tourists that are like going in and out of these little pools. Pamukkale is hot springs that have calcium water, and it's like therapeutic and spas and whatnot. But it's interesting because Laodicea is halfway between the Cotton Castle of Pamukkale and the snow-capped mountains of the Taurus Mountains. So standing on top of Laodicea, if you look to the south, you'll see snow, and if you look to the north, you'll see steam rising off of the hot water. And they're halfway between the hot and cold. And right in the middle of that, he says to the angel of the church at Laodicea, write, the Amen, the faithful, the true, the witness, the beginning of the creation, God says this, I know your deeds, that you're neither hot nor cold. I wish that you were cold or hot, so that because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth because you say I'm rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing, and you do not know that you are wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. Here's the thing. When people have found enough in this world, they're no longer hungry for another. When people believe that they can have heaven in the here and now, they're no longer looking for a heaven in the later. When people turn their attention and decide that everything that's important to them is for right now, they stop looking to serve Jesus and look for heaven in the future. All I'm saying is I think what these people were doing is that they were walking around tired of doing right. It's easier to just buy a nice car, get a nice house, live a nice life. Why should I worry about missions and world peace? Come on. I got enough to do. And I think they got weary in well-doing and started to seek pleasure instead of seeking passion for God. And I think in the end, all they did was got distracted by the luxuries. And I think it's easy to do. Do you know any Christians like any of these? Do you know any Christians that don't place God in their heart above all else? Do you know any Christians that pull back their witness because they're afraid of the reaction of people? Do you know any Christians who are tempted to join the unfaithful because the unfaithful seem like they're stronger? Or tolerate immorality because they don't want to fight everything or get apathetic to the truth, or they don't want to push too deliberately to build the body of believers, and they don't want to They don't want to have to stand up against the world's success, so they just fall into the pleasures. These are the hindrances of that church. And they're not just of that church. They're of every church of every age. You can always find these. So as we go to a break, if you're a modern Christian, you probably identify all of these as part of our church today. And this is the church which is. But soon, in chapter 4, verse 1, the heavens will open. And when the door stands open, Jesus will come.